I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Yeah. I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know.
Safe within your name. This we know. This we know. You promise never to forsake. What you begin, you will sustain. This we know. This we know. Save, rise.
shackles are no more, for Jesus Christ has broken every chain. All of the heavens and the earth announce the fullness of your word. This we know, this we know. And every enemy will see as we declare your victory. This we know.
Struggle is today, whatever sin you brought with you today, we've got a God who can deliver you from it and fully save you today from that destruction. The destruction that we brought on much of ourselves, Jesus Christ came to fulfill that, and He filled in the gaps for us, and He paid the debt that we could never pay ourselves. He's raising us up today. He's bringing us up. He's seating us at His table today, if we're willing. Let's go there, church. Let's worship Him around that table today. The head that once was crowned with thorns.
is crowned with glory now. The Savior knelt to wash our feet. Now at his feet we bow. The one who wore our sin and shame, now robed in majesty, the radiance of perfect love now shines for all to see. Your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King. Your name fear that held us now gives way to him who is our peace. His final breath upon the cross is now alive in me. Your name is victory.
From the ashes of defeat, the resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. By your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. By your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. Soldiers watched in vain, was borrowed for 3 days. His body there will not remain. Our God has robbed the grave. Our God has robbed the grave.
Your name, your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ. spirit, I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. By your spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. Is resurrecting me.
Last Sunday morning, the news came out that Kobe Bryant had died in a plane or a helicopter accident. And Kobe Bryant is one of the most prolific basketball players of our day. He played 20 seasons. He made 18 All-Star games, won 5 NBA championships, although he didn't do it by himself. He won 2 gold medals in the Olympics. He won 1 MVP award. And so he was this great, great ball player. But then, of course, on Sunday, he and his daughter and 7 others tragically lost their lives in that crash. And throughout this week, there have been memorials to the man and to his career. And I was thinking, as I heard those memorialize Kobe Bryant, that, you know, Paul, when he wrote to the churches, frequently used sports metaphors. And frequently he would say, the Christian life is like the race, or it's like the wrestling match. And in fact, in Christianity, the Greek word for sin means to miss the mark. It's an archery term. And as I thought about, again, the death of this prolific basketball player, I thought, is there not maybe something that, as we look at his sport, as we look at his career, that might speak to you and I at a deep spiritual level? And so this morning, I want to just talk to you about some lessons from the career of Kobe Bryant, some spiritual lessons that I think that I need, and if I need them, I think you need them. And so let's look at this prolific career just for a moment and think about what it might say to you and I. And as I look at his life, particularly on the basketball court, one of the things that it says to me is to keep shooting. Point one, keep shooting. You know, of all the career accomplishments that Kobe Bryant had as a great basketball player, and he's in the top 10 on the top 10 list of many statistical career records, there is one record that he holds by himself that may never be broken because he holds it by over 1,000 shots. And that is, he holds the career record for most missed shots, 14,481. Now, you would think that a 18-time All-Star would not hold the record for most missed shots. And again, he holds the record by over 1,000 shots over the second place person on that list. And yet, he does. And part of the reason that he was able to succeed as he did was that he just kept shooting the ball. In fact, I was reading through this week some of his worst games. And my, there are a lot of really bad Kobe Bryant games. And listen to these 3. And there's a long list of games he played where he really stunk. But June 16th, 2000, Game 5 of the NBA Finals, he hit 4 out of 20 shots. And he committed 5 fouls. So he committed more fouls than shots made. And his team lost by over 30 points. But he scored 8 points. And the guys he was guarding scored 57 points. He alone got outscored by 49 points in that game. They came back. They won game 6 and 7. They won the championship. 2015 on Thanksgiving, he shot 1 out of 14. He made 1 shot out of 14, so he missed 13 shots. And of the 13 shots he missed, 3 were air balls. He made 3 times as many air balls as made shots that day. One more. March 18, 2012, against the Utah Jazz, he made 3 out of 20 shots and committed 7 turnovers. Turned the ball far more than he made shots. And yet, he kept coming back, he kept coming back, he kept coming back, and he was always usually better the day after he laid an egg, but he just kept shooting the ball. And in your life, in my life, spiritually, you just have to keep coming back. When you mess up, when you lay an egg, or whatever euphemism you use for messing up, you just have to keep coming back. In fact, look at this passage in Proverbs. It says, "For a righteous man may fall 7 times and rise again." You said, "I didn't know I was a righteous man." Yeah, a righteous man may fall 7 times, but he'll rise again, but the wicked shall fall by calamity. Part of being a righteous person is when you fail, you keep getting up. When you miss, you keep getting up. All of you need to remember this verse so you can remind people of it in Micah. "Do not rejoice over me, my enemy, for when I fall, I will rise again." There needs to be something within us that says, when I go down, when I shoot 1 in 14 in life, when I commit more turnovers than I do shots, when I mess up in my life, I will rise again. If I fall 7 times, I'll rise 8 times, but I'm getting up. I'm not staying down. You need to say that in your life. You know, I remember back, I think it was 2003, when Kobe Bryant, it didn't look like maybe he was going to pull through because he was married, and he was caught in a hotel room with a woman who later accused him of rape. And so he went to trial, and I don't know the details of that case, but I know he went to trial. I know he lost most all of his endorsements, and it looked like his career was going to be over before it really got going. It looked like his marriage was finished, but I think what he did on the court, he did in his own life. He just kept going. He just kept shooting. He just kept driving. And, you know, as I look at the pictures of his family in the last few years, beautiful wife, 4 beautiful daughters, I look at the blessing of that, and they talk about how much he enjoyed being a father and coaching his daughters. I don't think he would have ever had that if he hadn't somehow, even when he was caught in that hotel room, said, "I'm going to come back. I'm going to get my wife back. I'm going to get this family back. I'm going to get back on track in my life." And you and I need to have that kind of spirit in our lives. Listen to him. You may have cheated on your wife. You may have cheated on your husband. You know what? Get him back. Now, that may not be in the words you say, because they're not dumb. They don't want to hear your words and see your tears. They want to see some action. So it may take a few months. It may take a few years to convince them that that's not who you are. But get back up. Keep shooting. Fight. Don't quit. Get your family back. Some of you maybe have fallen this week. A room this size, Somebody fell into temptation that they thought they wouldn't have to deal with anymore. They thought they were over that, but you fell. Some of you maybe have an addiction and you relapsed this week. Get back up, keep shooting, go again. You know, if you're in college, it's okay to fail some classes. I failed some classes. And you want to do better than I have done in life, but you can be a preacher and fail some classes. I don't know if you can be a doctor or a lawyer or whatever, but you can fail some classes and you can keep going. And listen, if you want to drop out, if God's telling you to drop out of college, God's telling you to drop out of high school, then drop out. But I'll tell you how you know if God's telling you. Your parents will tell you to drop out because they're in authority over you at the moment. So if your parents are telling you God told us to tell you to drop out, go ahead and drop out. But if you haven't heard that, get up, take the class over, keep going, keep driving, keep shooting in your life. You just have to keep going. Everybody's got a past. Everybody's got stuff back there. And we all have to recover from a 3-for-20 shooting with 7 turnovers in our life. We all look back, and there's some stink back there, but keep going. Keep going. I remember reading about this lady. Her name was Edith. Several years ago, she lived in Darlington, Maryland. She had 8 kids. She went to see the neighbor. She came back across the driveway, across the road to her house, and her 5 smallest kids were huddled in the front yard looking at something. And she didn't know what it was, but when she got closer, she saw that they were huddled around 5 baby skunks. And she impulsively yelled, "Run!" And each of them grabbed a skunk and ran in a different direction. The point of that story is, don't run with your stink. Drop your skunk. Drop that stuff. If you stunk yesterday, don't carry it in today. If you stunk last year, don't carry it into this year. If you stunk for all your 20s and 30s, don't carry it into your 40s. Drop your skunk. Keep moving. Keep shooting in your life. Something else when you think of the career of Kobe Bryant is this. Don't just keep shooting, but play through the pain. Play through the pain. You know, for 20 years, you say, wow, he was pretty healthy to play for 20 years. But I was reading his list of injuries. 1999, broken wrist. 2000, bum ankle. 2001, hip and elbow bursitis, a sore shoulder and pinky. 2003, shoulder injury. 2004, re-aggravated his surgically repaired shoulder. 2005, missed a month with a severely sprained ankle. 2006, knee surgery. 2007, sprained ankle. 2008, back injury. 2009, messed up his index finger, which may not seem like a lot, but remember his profession is shooting a ball. The fingers really matter. And because he did not miss any games, he did not let it heal properly. And so for the second half of his career, he had to deal with a finger that caused him problems because he would not stop. He would not let it heal. 2009, sprained ankle. 2010, he went to Germany, had surgery on his right knee, came back, won another championship, but it was revealed that he had very little cartilage in his knee left. He didn't have a knee replacement. Obviously, he played 5 more years with very little cartilage in his right knee. 2011, sprained ankle. 2012, torn wrist element. 2013, fractured knee. 2013 later, Achilles tendon and surgery. Reminds you of Kathy Tipton. No, I'm joking. Where's Kathy? Yeah. She had a lot of surgeries. But think about that. seemed like every year he had a surgery, every year he played in pain. And I think what the Bible would tell you and I is, listen, if you're going to make it for the Lord, not only are you and I going to have to keep shooting, we're going to have to keep getting up. If we fall seven times, we got to get up an eighth. But we're going to have to play through some pain. I like how Paul said it. Paul said, here's my list of ailments in the ministry of the Lord. He said, from the Jews, five times I received 40 stripes plus minus one. Three times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. Three times I was shipwrecked. I mean, you wouldn't want to ride a ship with that guy. It's bad luck. A night and a day, I've been in the deep, which means for 24 hours, he's floating in the water, maybe on a piece of wood. In journeys often, in perils of waters, in perils of robbers, in perils of my own countrymen, in perils of Gentiles, in perils of the city. I mean, you read that and you decide, was there anybody in the Roman Empire not trying to kill him? In perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and toil, in sleeplessness, often, sounds like a mother, doesn't he? In sleeplessness, often, in hunger and thirst, in fastings often, in cold and nakedness, besides the other things. I just got the other things. He got all that, and besides the other stuff, what comes on me daily, but my deep concern, which is my deep concern for all the churches. So not only did he have all that other stuff, but he's worried about all the churches. He says, but who is weak? Am I not weak? And who is made to stumble? In other words, who's trying to trip you? Everybody's trying to make me stumble. Who is made to stumble? And I do not burn with indignation. In other words, everybody's out to get me. But am I angry? Am I walking around mad all the time? Am I burning angry? No, although they're all out trying to get me. Now listen to me. If you serve the Lord long enough, you're going to have your own list of injuries. You're going to have your own list. You're going to have people that don't like you. They don't like your stand, but stand anyway. You're going to have people that don't care for your beliefs, but believe anyway. You're going to have people that don't like your commitment to Jesus, but be committed anyway. If you serve the Lord long enough, you're going to have to sit in church one day and raise your hands and worship when people in that church are gossiping about you. You're just going to have to do that. It's amazing how Paul, almost to every church, pointed out gossiping in their midst. You're going to have to deal with that if you're going to serve the Lord. You're going to have to deal with rejection. Even in the body of Christ, you have to deal with rejection. You're going to have to deal with trials, with circumstances. You're going to have to deal with situations in your own life. You may have to stand and worship the Lord in the midst of a divorce. You're going to have to stand and worship the Lord in the midst of kids going crazy. You're going to have to stand in spite of it all. You're going to have to play through some hurt in your life. And sometimes you're just going to have to say, though the Lord slay me, still I will serve him. You might have to say, oh, wicked ones, you may throw me in the fire, and the Lord will deliver me, but even if he doesn't, I'm still going to stand in the fire. That's going to have to be your attitude, where you say, I am going to play hurt. I'm going to play bruised. I'm going to worship the Lord, even though sometimes I don't feel like it, even though flames are coming at me, even though I don't feel loved in this room, I'm still going to serve the Lord. You're going to have to play hurt in this life. Something else that Kobe Bryant did. Not only did he keep shooting, not only did he play hurt, but he worked hard. In fact, he said in an interview, he said, I have nothing in common with lazy people. I have nothing in common with lazy people who blame others for their lack of success. Great things come from hard work and perseverance. No excuses. And they said that he had in his mind at every practice, he had to make 400 shots. Now, I told you, how he could be cold, so he might have had to shoot 1,500 at some practices. But he wouldn't stop till he made at least 400. And during the off season, when he would practice, he had to make at least 800. And they said during halftime, he would often go in and watch tape of the things he had done wrong in the first half to correct in the second half. He was a hard worker. Look what Paul says about the Christian faith. Next one, if you will, Bill. Paul says, as a Christian, but I discipline my body, and I bring it into subjection, lest when I have preached to others, I myself should become disqualified. But look at him. He says, I got to work hard too. If you're going to be a believer, I have to keep myself in subjection. See, listen to me. Abundant life, the great things that can be yours as a believer, oftentimes come through grace, but also hard work as you take hold of grace. There's a lot of things in life that even as a believer, you're not going to get unless you work hard, unless you learn them. In fact, look at Philippians chapter 4. He said, this is Paul again. He says, I know how to be abased, and I know how to abound. In other words, I know how to drive a Corolla. I know how to drive a Cadillac. He said, everywhere and all things, I have learned both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Now hold this up for a second. He says, I know now I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. But how did he get there? He said, I had to learn it. I have learned how to be hungry, how to be full. I've learned how to be content regardless of where I'm at, regardless of what I've got. And because I've learned to be content, I now have a faith and a confidence that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Now, you have, again, to learn that. How do you learn it? You got to work at it. You got to dig in. You got to be diligent with the word. You got to be diligent with your prayer life. You have to be diligent in your meditation. You have to be diligent in your worship. You have to go to school. You have to learn. You have to work at it. And when you get to that place, man, that's a place of blessedness. When you can be anywhere with anybody, with anything, and you've learned the secret of contentment, you abound regardless of where you at. Man, that is a blessed place for a believer, but you got to work to get there. Got to work to get there. One other thing. Look at Kobe Bryant, and he kept shooting. He didn't quit when he had a skunk. He knew how to let the skunks go in life. He played when he hurt. He kept going when he hurt. He kept working hard. Even when he got to the point in his career when he could have coasted, he never coasted. Something else he did. He valued teammates. He valued teammates. You know, he would have never won a championship if he hadn't had good players with him. He needed a Shaquille O'Neal in his life. And you need a Shaquille O'Neal. You need a 7-foot giant to help you in some areas in life. You need some friends. You need some people around you. Listen to me. We know basketball is a team sport, but life is a team sport. And you're not going to get very far unless you have the right people around you, helping you, encouraging you, pushing you in the right direction. I was talking to a friend this week. And one of our ministerial friends, it just seems like he's blowing up his life. And I asked my friend who is closer to him, I said, who's he listening to? And he said, nobody. He won't listen to anybody. And that's his problem. If he had some people around him and if he would listen to them, he wouldn't be in the mess he's in right now. You've got to have people around you, godly people who will help you if you're going to be a champion for Christ Jesus. And you need God in your life. You need God in your life. Listen to me. You need God in your life. Look at Romans chapter 7. Paul, before God was in his life, when he was trying to do it himself, he said, "For I know that in me nothing good dwells, for the will is present with me." He said, "I want to be good, but how to perform what is good I do not find. For the good that I will do, I do not do, but the evil I will not do, that I practice." Now, that's chapter 7. In chapter 8, he says, "But thanks be to God." And he talks about the Spirit coming into his life. And that makes a difference. But listen to me. On your own, you can't do it. You'll never be the husband that you really want to be without the help of God. You're never going to be the mother that you really want to be without God. You're never going to be the person. You can't say no to what you need to say no to. But the Bible says that Jesus Christ is able to save to the uttermost. The older preachers used to say, from the guttermost to the uttermost, Jesus Christ can save. That's Hebrews chapter 7, 25. Hebrews chapter 2, 18 says that he is able to keep us. He's able to keep us. The Bible says that he is able to preserve us. Everything we've committed to him, he's able to preserve us. He is able to preserve us faultless before the day of judgment. Listen to me, you're not going to overcome your addiction. Even non-Christian 12-steps say you got to figure out a higher power. And the difference in Celebrate Recovery is we name our higher power. We know his name. But even the 12-step says you're not in and of yourself able to consistently beat addictions in your life. Sometimes you beat one and it just comes up in another area of your life. You think you've beaten it, but you look around and all that energy is being funneled into something else in your life. I mean, you think you've beaten alcohol, but now you got an addiction to tobacco, or you beat the one with tobacco and now you got an addiction to Facebook or whatever. I mean, it all funnels itself. You beat one, it's like whack-a-mole when you're trying to do it yourself. It comes back up somewhere else. But Jesus Christ, listen to me. You need him. You can't do it on your own. And I wish the Holy Spirit would just take that and drive it into your mind, because some of you act like you can do it on your own. Listen, I know you're not reading your Bible. I know you're not praying. I know you're not worshiping like you should. I know you're trying to grunt it out in your life. You're trying to be the person you ought to be through willpower. It's not going to work. It's not going to work in your life. You need Jesus. Stand with me. They say that on the Sunday morning before the helicopter went down, that Kobe Bryant and his daughter went to church, 7 a.m. And I hope that meant something to him. I don't know, obviously, where he was with the Lord, but I think it says something good that he could have easily ran off and done basketball all day, but he went to church first. I think that says something good about him. But I don't know what his thoughts were as it became sort of clear that it was going to crash. But I don't think he regretted going to church that morning. I don't think that he did. But in basketball, when the buzzer's going to sound. When the game's over. In life, you don't know. So you want to live without regrets. Every day is important because you don't know when the buzzer is going to sound. Kobe Bryant was my age. You don't know when it's going to sound. If you will keep getting up, if you will play through the hurt, you'll be able to live a life without regrets. You're going to regret getting knocked out. you're going to regret not staying in there when the fire got hot and trusting the Lord to bring you through. Live without regrets. I'm looking around this room today, and I don't know, this may be from the Lord. I just feel I need to say this. Somebody here needs to let go of a skunk in their life. It's time to move past the bad week, the bad month, the bad year. It's time to put some stuff on the altar today. It's time to move beyond it. And I believe God is speaking to someone who's saying, bring that stuff to me. Just bring that skunk to me. You trying to lay it down? You know, sometimes it helps just to take out a piece of paper, write it down, and lay it on the altar. It's almost telling Satan, I'm done with it. I've left it with the Lord. I'm moving on. I'm not being bound by the stink of my past anymore. God's speaking to someone here today and telling you there's freedom. There's freedom for you. There's freedom. There's a new start for you today. Some of you have been hurt, and I know you've been hurt. If I'm the one who's hurt you, come to me. I want to make it right. But God can help you play through the hurt. He can help you play through the pain in your family. He can help you get through the divorce. He can help you get through the struggles. He can help your faith remain strong in the fire that you're in today. Yes. You might want to come to Him and say, Lord, with your help, I can't do it alone. And I feel weak, but with your help, I believe you're going to save me to the uttermost in this situation. I don't know where you're at today. Somebody needs God today. Somebody's away from the Lord. You've never come to God, and you're dealing with all the stuff in your past. What those gals experienced in baptism, you've never experienced the cleanness in your life. But we have a Savior who saves, and you need Him today. If you'd invite Him into your life, He'd come, and He would begin to make all things new from the inside, working out in you. And you'd be able to face what you're up against today. Let's sing together. Let's sing together. Why don't you come? Why don't you bring some stuff to the Lord today? Why don't you bring it all? Bring it all. Bring everything to Him today, because He's able to handle your stuff. He can handle you. Will you sing, my brother?
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear.
Amen. We can be fearless today.
Even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back.
No, He's near today.
I will
he can't
feel
be.
Your evil.
Amen.
For my God is with me. And if my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear?
Oh,
God's speaking to our hearts today. Amen. He may not be done this morning. We're not going to put him on a clock. We're not going to tie his hands this morning. We're going to let him work. If he's talked to you this morning, it's not too late.
All the way my Savior leads me, who am I to ask beside? How could I doubt his tender mercy? Who through life has been my guide? All the way my Savior leads me, and cheers each winding path I tread, and gives me grace for every trial.
Thank you, Lord.
Feeds me with the living bread. You lead me and keep me from falling. You carry me close to your heart, and surely your goodness and mercy will follow me all the way my Savior leads me. Oh, the fullness of his love. Oh, the sureness of his promise. In the triumph of his blood, when my spirit clothed immortal wings its flight to realms of days. Is your song? This my song through endless ages. Could I doubt your tender mercy? Who through life has been my guide?
When my spirit
clothed immortal wings its flight to realms of day. This my song through endless ages.